be a move. Good news, everyone.
Don't you know, Diggy, when you see it, onions have
legs. Welcome to 20th Century Boy. My name is Running Machine. And this is the inside of my mind. Welcome to the podcast, everyone. Another week. I was just... didn't plan to say this. I was just hanging out with a friend. And I said to him, like, you know, sometimes my life literally just feels like every single week just goes so fast. And I literally wake up every Monday and I'm like, ah, it's Monday again. And now I'm just doing it all again. Life is just so rote like that. Anyway, those are the kinds of nuggets of wisdom you can get on this podcast. Of course, this podcast is actually called 20th Century Boy, a podcast by me, Radio Mike, a young writer and producer from here in Melbourne, Australia, just trying to make his way through life. Sometimes it's easier than other times. At the moment, it's pretty good, actually. I'm feeling pretty happy. And that's the most important thing in life. Started this week with Running Machine. Every week, if you don't know, I start with a different name. Generally, it's RM themed because my real name is Radio Mike. Running Machine this week comes from Radio Sydney. Welcome to the Radio family, Radio Sydney, who commented on my Strava runs. I'm on Strava. Follow me on Strava if you've got it. One of my Strava runs where I did two runs like back to back, and Sydney commented and he was like, Running Machine for this week's pod. So there it is, Sydney. Submit your own at any time. Get in touch with the show, radio.mike on Instagram, radiomikepod@gmail.com. Guys, of course, I do have to do the obligatory Patreon plug at the top of every podcast. Patreon.com/radiomike. I'll make it simple. $1 a month is $12 a year. That's 3 coffees a year. If you'd have a coffee with me 3 times a year, please jump on the Patreon. It really helps the show keep running. The show is expensive to produce. I'd love to break even on it at some point. And you won't even notice the money leaving your account. It's $1 a month, right? Jump on the Patreon. If you haven't done it, then you're like, I probably should do that. Like, I would give Mike $1 a month. Please just do it right now. Patreon.com/RadioMike. Open the app. Sign up. I know the biggest hassle is just signing up to Patreon, because then I reckon most of you would just do it if you could just press a button. But it really does help, and you get access to 2 bonus podcasts, the Pat and Mike Show, where me and producer Pat, the producer of this podcast, talk behind-the-scenes stuff, as well as the Overflow, which is the TCB Overflow, which goes up as soon as this podcast goes up. So as soon as you finish this podcast, you then go and listen to the Overflow for another little more casual kind of 15-minute to 20-minute chat with you guys. So a bit of bonus content there. Last week, I talked a little bit, actually, about the Johnny Depp Amber Heard case. And this week I'm going to talk a little bit more about that, I think, because it's been very interesting to watch. So if you want to hear my thoughts on that, head over to the Overflow on Patreon, $1 a month. Or if you think there's generally four weeks in a month, if you think that means 4 episodes of this podcast in a month, if you think every episode is worth $1, which really, $1 per episode seems actually quite fair. If you would fling me $1 for every episode of this pod, $4 a month over on Patreon. Please do it. You get the Overflow. It's really good. Anyway, that is all I'll say, just to implore you to hopefully sign up to the Patreon. We have 54 patrons. We would love to see it get up to 60. So if you've been considering signing up, please do so. We would love to see you there. Love to hear your thoughts over in the Overflow podcast. So please jump on there. This week as well, producer Pat did a solo episode of the Pat and Mike Show where it was just Pat, no Mike, which was very interesting, and he did a fantastic job. Did get a message here from Patreo Cody Tachibana. Welcome to the radio family, Patreo, because you are a Patreon. He said, because last week, I believe a listener wrote in saying they were too young to jump onto Patreon because they don't have a credit card. Hey, just food for thought. Patreo Cody says, hey Mike, quick little tidbit for that listener who wrote in saying they wish they could jump on Patreon but couldn't because they're 13 and can't get a card. Coles and Woolworths both sell prepaid MasterCards which can top up and use online, essentially like a gift card. There's an option for you if you do want to spend your pocket money on this podcast. That would be awesome. Would love to continue encouraging people to get in touch with the show. That is what this show is all about. I was also talking with a friend the other day about radio and podcasting and the future of the industry and what content's going to look like. And I think You know, the thing about radio that podcasts don't have is that radio is an instant communication medium. Like, you can call a radio show instantly and be on. You can't do that with podcasts, but you can have your voice on this podcast. You can send a voice message with any thoughts, queries, concerns, questions at any time. Just dial 1-800-438-353 on your phone and leave a voicemail. Then I can play it on this show. Really want to encourage that, more of that to be happening. I miss having more voices on the show. And as well as that, you can contribute, as I said, radio.mike on Instagram, radiomikepod@gmail.com, anything you want to know, just like Radio Vinny did. Welcome to the RF Radio, Vinny. Thanks for getting in touch with the show. He said, I'm just up to the grilled saga during the 2021 season of 20th Century Boy. And since you had a change of heart with their burgers, I decided to give them a try today on my uni break. Well, I've gone to Grilled in Macquarie Centre in Sydney, and they've kicked me out because they're not open. And he's put not open in quotation marks, as if it's like just them saying they're not open. Also, you're in Sydney, so that's another fault of yours. You're in Sydney. That probably explains it, because as you know, Sydney is the worst city in Australia. Very controversial take that got a lot of criticism online, by the way. My take on Sydney being the worst city in Australia. Oh, well. This is such an edgy podcast. Wow. He continues. This is unacceptable. I'm team against Grilled until this can be resolved. Interesting. So they're not open, Vinny. What time did you go? Because maybe you went at like midnight and of course they wouldn't be open. I don't know. You haven't given that detail. He continues. After that, I head to the Hungry Jack's and now they're saying their Angus machine is broken. WTF does that even mean? Moral of the story is I'm having a bad day and your podcast is getting me through it. Cheers for being such a great listen, Radio Vinny. Thank you so much, Vinny. Appreciate you writing into the show. It means a lot. Radio Chloe also sent in a short little message. She said, hey, Mike, I'm COVID positive and have managed to smash out pretty much all of your episodes. Some thoughts and feelings. And she lists them. First one, Hillary Duff will always be number one. Hey now, hey now. Yes, she will. Number two, bring back Lizzie McGuire. Number three, Hillary for life. So we do have a Hillary Duff fan. Definitely reached a new audience with that Hillary Duff episode of this podcast that I did. Lots of new female listeners, which is great. We haven't done one of these for a while, so I wanted to start the show with this. Trivia question of the week. I do a little dance on the video version, guys. I just said I do a little dance on the video version, so go and check that out. This week it's an audio-based trivia question. I think I've done one of these before. I'm going to play a song in reverse. To answer the trivia question of the week, you ring the hotline, 1-800-438-353, as I said, and say, hey, Mike, it's Radio Johnny here. Here's the answer to this week's trivia question. It's this, right? Send it in. But this week, what is this song? I'm going to play a song in reverse. You send in a message. Tell me what this song is. Everyone knows this song. There is no one listening to this podcast that doesn't know the song. Anyway, here it is. Here's the trivia question of the week. That's it. That's your excerpt there. I'll play it one more time. Send in your answer, 1-800-438-353. Want more voices on the show? Call for anything. Guys, that is a big plug right there. Couple updates. Do have to do an update on movie premieres. Over the past few weeks on the show, I've been complaining about how I am obviously an influencer, but I am being totally snubbed from Australian and Melbourne-based movie premieres. Couple updates. This is really interesting because a message has come in from Disney Australia. I must be on some PR list for Disney because I get like PR press releases being like, oh, Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness out now in cinemas. Here's the trailer. Like I get sent those, like these automatic press releases. So I must be on the list. So I'm like, oh, let's leverage this. I reply to this press release. It's a person called Paige who works at Disney. Welcome, Paige. And I basically just said, hey, look, my name's Mike. I'm a producer. I have a podcast. Here's the listenership. It's quite good. Would love to be on a list for these events. I cover this kind of stuff. Would love to be going to premieres. Please invite me. Get this great reply. You'll never believe this. Hi, Mike. Thanks for getting in touch! Exclamation mark. Not a full stop. Exclamation mark. That's an exclaim. I've passed your info on to the team who handles our invites, and they'll be sure to keep you in mind for Marvel premieres going forward. Best, Paige. And you're right, Paige, that is the best, because we probably couldn't have hoped for anything more at this point. That is a huge result for us and this show. And you know what? If I do start getting invited to Marvel premieres and they give me a plus one, which I think they do, here's a promise I'm making to you guys, the listeners, if you get around this, okay? If I do start getting invited to Marvel or any movie premieres and I get a plus one, you will be able to win the plus one on this show. I will give away plus ones. I don't know if I'm allowed to do this. Well, it's a plus one. I can bring anyone. So I'm allowed to turn it into a game on my podcast. I will have a way that you can win a plus one to the Melbourne premiere of the Marvel movies, provided I start getting invited to them. The next one's Thor Love and Thunder, which I think comes out in July. So we'll see. I'll do another push. Got another interesting email from Radio Leon. He's actually Leon Shergan. He's an executive producer of a radio show here in Melbourne called Fifi, Fev and Nick on the Fox. Shout out to Leon, because I got this email from him. It was simply titled in the subject, Movie Premieres. And I was like, oh, what's this? Here's what it says. Hey, mate, if you want to try and get some invites to screenings, I'd shoot an email separately to these contacts, explain who you are, and that you would like to be kept across any release schedules, press releases, and opportunities. You should then hopefully get added to their mail outs. Hopefully see you at the next one. He then links a couple of people's contacts from different companies like Disney, other stuff. So we do have another avenue. We'll see how this works with Paige, but good to see people sticking up for me. I want to be invited to... Goal of the show for this year, I want to be invited to a premiere. And if I'm not, I'm cancelling the podcast forever. No, I won't do that. But I do want to be invited to a premiere. Of course, on the topic of Marvel, and these three kind of next things lead into each other a fair bit, I did go and see Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. The latest Marvel Cinematic Universe film, which I talk about on this podcast from time to time. No spoilers, by the way, so don't worry, I'm not going to spoil anything. But I did really enjoy it. I will do a YouTube video that should be up in the next few days or at the moment, so go on the YouTube and subscribe with my full thoughts. But generally, I thought it was a pretty good movie. I thought it did go a little bit too long. I thought it could have been maybe 10, 15 minutes shorter, but that's probably just me. You guys know I have a thing with long movies. Like, everyone roasted me for saying Batman isn't good because it's 3 hours long, but I stand by that. Batman is too long. 3 hour movies are just too long for me. Maybe not for you, for me. But yeah, really enjoyed Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. Really like the Marvel multiverse concept. And, you know, if you've seen Spider-Man No Way Home, it links into that movie a bit as well with, previous Spider-Man villains appearing in that movie. So it was really cool. And I also really liked, because I saw the first Doctor Strange when it came out. And if you're not familiar with the MCU, I'll just like paint a picture for you. Doctor Strange is like, his backstory is he was a surgeon or a doctor. Like he's a literal doctor. He's kind of a unique character because you've got like Iron Man was Tony Stark. Captain America was Steve Rogers, whereas Doctor Strange literally is Dr. Stephen Strange. Like, he was a doctor, and then he becomes, like, he's a sorcerer, or, like, he has the power of magic, essentially. Cool superpower, cool character. Didn't really like the first Doctor Strange movie where they introduced him. He was one of the later Avengers to come in, and I just thought his character, because he starts off as a very arrogant kind of doctor, who thinks he's the best. And then he, from there, like, yeah, gets the power of magic. So I thought his story was very similar to Tony Stark's, who again was like an arrogant billionaire, millionaire or whatever, who, yeah, becomes, who invents the Iron Man suit and whatever. I thought they were really similar characters, so I didn't like love Doctor Strange, but I have liked his development over the MCU, and I did like him in this movie. I think Benedict Cumberbatch, however you say his fucking name, was really good as well. So yeah, I thought Doctor Strange was good. There's been a meme going around over predominantly on Twitter, where people post a picture of like a famous crossover in media and they go, this was my multiverse of madness. Because like, you know, the idea of the multiverse is like different universes coming together and colliding. So I did one this week, which was actually a picture, and it did like, for my standards, it did quite well on Twitter. Which definitely isn't that good. But I did a picture of the movie The Rugrats Go Wild, and I just put, this was my multiverse of madness, which of course is the movie in which the Rugrats cross over with other Nickelodeon franchise, The Wild Thornberrys, in a movie. Great movie. Should watch it again. And it got me thinking, and I'd love for you guys to send these in however you'd like. I have mentioned ways to send stuff in already on this pod. Best crossovers of all time. What are they? Put it out there. Spider-Man No Way Home is definitely up there. But I was like, because I do remember as a kid thinking that crossover episodes of shows, like they did them a lot in cartoons. Because, and this is exactly what they want. Like they want their, like Disney puts the characters of Recess in an episode of Lilo and Stitch, right? The Lilo and Stitch show where they collect all the experiments. And it's like, this is exactly what they want. They want kids to be like, what? They exist in the same world? The kids from Recess can go to Hawaii and meet Lilo and Stitch? Like, huge. Huge moments, and all the kids love it, and that's exactly what they want by crossing over. Cross-contamination of your franchises. So I do remember them being really special growing up. One crossover that I actually remember being huge for me, that I always wanted to happen, and it finally did officially happen, and if you haven't seen it, you should watch it, was the Simpsons crossover with Family Guy, probably about 5 or 6 years ago, maybe more. Family Guy did an episode called The Simpsons Guy, in which the Griffin family from Family Guy go to Springfield, and they meet Homer, Marge, Butler, everyone from Springfield, and they play up a lot of, it's very meta, it's very fourth wall breaky. It's great to see these two iconic characters, Peter Griffin and Homer Simpson, on the screen together, and just like hearing them, there's a great meta point where the beer from Family Guy, Pawtucket Beer or Brewery, Pawtucket Ale or whatever, turns out is just a copy of Duff. They've put the label over Duff beer from The Simpsons. And I think that was a really funny like point. They were like joking about how Family Guy was really derivative of The Simpsons. I'll put some audio of that in here because I think it's a really funny moment.
This beer tastes exactly like Duff. It's just a lousy ripoff.
Hey, whoa, whoa, whoa. It's not a ripoff of Duff. It may have been inspired by Duff, but I like to think it goes in a different direction.
And that actually also reminds me of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, that movie from, I think it was the 90s or maybe the 80s, in which there's like Toon World where all the cartoons lived. And it's, I think to this day, the only time that Mickey Mouse and Bugs Bunny have appeared on screen together, when they fall from the sky and they're parachuting down. There was actually an agreement between Disney and Warner Brothers, I believe, that they had to be on screen for the exact same amount of animation frames, and they had to both have the exact same amount of lines of dialogue. So there's that iconic scene where the main character's falling out of a building and Mickey Mouse and Bugs Bunny drop down with parachutes and have this little interaction. Maybe I'll cut some audio of it here.
What's up, Doc? Jumping without a parachute? Kinda dangerous, ain't it?
Yeah. You could get killed, huh?
But that's a question I want to put out to you guys today. Write it into the show. What is your favorite crossover moment in fiction? Because it does happen a lot more than we think. Like, The Simpsons crossed over with The X-Files in that episode. We all know the one. Simpsons crossover with X-Files. I'm pretty sure there was an episode of Two and a Half Men that crossed over with one of the crime procedurals. Like, I think Two and a Half Men did a crossover episode with, like, NCIS or Law and Order or something like that. So there's a lot of wacky ones. There's the classic, like, Flintstones meet the Jetsons. So there's a lot of crossover episodes of things and crossover movies. There's Freddy versus Jason, which I've never seen, but that obviously takes Freddy from Nightmare on Elm Street and Jason from Friday the 13th, and they cross over and fight these two iconic horror villains. So I think that's really cool, and would love for people to write in what theirs are. On a quick note, thinking about the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which I've talked about a lot on this podcast, about kind of how it's a great case study of business and how to get people engaged and interested in your franchise and getting people in from a pop culture sphere and dominating kind of every aspect of pop culture. And, you know, we all know that the MCU kind of, you know, if you don't know, movie of Iron Man, movie of Thor, movie of Hulk, separate movies, and then bam, now there's an Avengers movie where they're all teaming up together, right? That's the general concept, having a universe of movies. Basically, it's like, it's kind of like having a TV series, but it's all movies, right? They all interconnect. You have to see them all to understand the full story. You have to get everything. Realize that there's one franchise that almost did this. Well, there's a few, but there's one franchise in particular that almost did this before Marvel. There's one franchise that I believe, I have a conspiracy theory here, guys. There is a franchise out there that I believe was attempting to do the Marvel Cinematic Universe before Marvel did it. And I believe I have evidence to prove it. Because I genuinely believe, conspiracy theory time, that the creators of Shrek fully intended to develop a fully fleshed out Shrek CU, Shrek Cinematic Universe. Now, hear me out for a second here, okay? I'm being so serious about this because over the weekend, just on a whim, I watched a movie I've never seen before. That movie is called Puss in Boots. It is a spin-off of Shrek that is the origin story of the character Puss in Boots, who first appears in Shrek 2. Antonio Banderas reprises his role. If you've seen this movie, let me know. He meets Humpty Dumpty. It's set in the universe of Shrek. It's, you know, it's the same character. And so they do this Puss in Boots spin-off movie. Obviously, they've done Shrek, Shrek 2, I think Shrek 3 at this time, maybe even Shrek 4, and then they do Puss in Boots. I believe that Puss in Boots was DreamWorks' attempt to begin a proposed Shrek cinematic universe. The movie actually did really pretty well considering. It grossed about $400 million. It profited about $400 million. Budget of I think, $100 million, gross of $500 million. So $400 million left, right? That's pretty good. And here's the thing. I think after the failure of the fourth Shrek iteration, Shrek Forever After, I genuinely do believe deep down there was a plan to do the Shrek CU, but because Shrek Forever After was a terribly written film, an unnecessary entry into the otherwise almost unblemished Shrek franchise, let's be honest, Shrek the Third wasn't great, but it's an okay movie that does hold up, one and two, near masterpieces. I think after Shrek Forever After was what it was, people lost faith in the Shrek CU concept. I believe there was not only a Puss in Boots movie planned. Puss in Boots got released, made it, did well. I believe there was a Donkey prequel. I genuinely believe there was a Gingerbread Man prequel in the works. I really think we were going to see the Gingerbread Man be made on Drury Lane with the Muffin Man. I'm telling you, I believe that's true. I think there was a DreamWorks Pinocchio in the works. I think there was a Dragon and Donkey sequel team-up film in the works. I honestly think there could have been a spec script written for the Lord Farquaad prequel. How Lord Farquaad became Lord Farquaad. And I reckon he was bullied all his life for being small, and that's why he became the ruthless ruler he was in Shrek 1. I also think they could have explored the story we know about Fiona's dad being born as a frog or whatever it was, like he kissed the princess to become. I reckon there could have been a prequel about that and how he worked with Fairy Godmother. We know that happened, but we don't see it. It's kind of like Fantastic Beasts, The Secrets of Dumbledore. Finding out all this stuff about Dumbledore, we already kind of know about it from the books, but now they're fleshing it out on the screen. We could have had that for Shrek, the Shrek CU. Imagine this, guys. A Fairy Godmother Prince Charming prequel. Prince Charming sequel. Who else is there in Shrek? Three Little Pigs prequel. See how they all made it to Shrek's swamp that day. Who was the woman that had Donkey in Shrek 1 that tried to sell him off and he ran away? Who was that woman? What is Donkey's story? I would love to see Donkey in a prequel role, but because of Shrek Forever After, it won't happen. The Shrek CU was doomed until I realized that, in fact, there is a sequel to the Puss in Boots movie coming out. And that movie, 11 years after the original, right? What happened? Something happened there. Something weird happened. 11 years later, Puss in Boots The Last Wish will be released December 21, 2022. And I'm going to call this now. I'm genuinely going to make a really, really bold call right now, okay? I think that this movie will be the resurgence of the Shrek CU. I'm calling it now. There is no way they're not going down this path. I believe that at some point in this movie, either directly or indirectly, Shrek will appear. He might not have any lines, but it'll just be a cameo. He'll be in the background. He'll be somewhere. There'll be something to do with Shrek. I think Donkey might appear in passing. Probably not voiced, because unless they're doing a Marvel-style deal, they're not going to get Eddie Murphy to voice him for like one line in a movie. But I think that characters from Shrek will appear in this movie and it will kick off the Shrek CU. Calling it now, it's a big call, but I'm maintaining it because I believe that the Shrek CU is our most unfortunate loss in this world. Imagine how different the world would be if the Shrek CU did go ahead. Just putting it out there, guys. If you think of any other movies that would be good in the Shrek CU, let me know. Actually, here's a challenge as well. A few things I'm going to put out to you guys. Feel free to call the hotline or just write in. Pitch me a movie in the Shrek CU. Or even better, pitch me phase one of the Shrek CU. That's what they do in Marvel. They have phase one, phase two, phase three. Pitch me an SCU movie. Pitch me the Lord Farquaad prequel movie in an email. Pitch me the Donkey prequel movie. Pitch me any movie in the Shrek CU. I want to build it on this show over the next few weeks. Someone send in some concepts. Someone please do it. I know you're a creative bunch. Right into the show. Last week on the show, I asked you guys if there are specific songs that remind you of specific times in your life. A lot of people wrote in. And I've chosen a couple of the ones that I thought were the funniest. Okay? So I got this one from Radio Westy Snipes. This made me laugh. And it was because I was talking about like the power of music and I went to this live show a few weekends ago and it just transported me back to a time in my life where I was listening to those songs and those albums and whatnot. Radio Westy Snipes sent in Boulevard of Broken Dreams by Green Day. Takes me back to getting dumped for the first time in year six. I do think this is really funny because the idea of a year six student being in a relationship at like age 11 and actually having a breakup at age 11 and then going home and being like, oh, I just can't believe she dumped me. And listening to like a really emo Green Day song. Hilarious. Amazing. Radio Leroy, who is actually a friend of mine who responded to this, and he's told me this story before, but I don't think I've ever told this on the podcast, but it's hilarious. He sent me a message saying just simply Chasing Cars by whoever that, what's the band that sings Chasing Cars? Is it Evermore? It's definitely not Evermore. It is Snow Patrol. Chasing Cars by Snow Patrol.
If I lay here, if I just lay here, would you lie with me and just forget the world?
Now, the reason this is funny is because he told me this story once where he was dating this girl for a while and they were, you know, hanging out, and I think they were like at a lookout or something and just in the moonlight under the stars, and he thought it would be a good idea to turn to this girl he was dating, and he turned to her and he literally said to her face, "Ladies, let me know how you would feel if a man did this to you." Turned to her face and said verbatim, I can't remember the girl's name. Say it was Sally. He was just like, "Sally, if I lay here, would you lie with me and just forget the world?"
If I lay here.
Now, you might think that that would be enough for someone to vomit in their mouths by how lame it is. Here's some news for you. They're in a long-term relationship for over 10 years. So it definitely worked. So guys, if you are, guys and girls, if you're trying to like convince someone to love you, which we all try to do from time to time, send them turn to their face and just quote the lyrics of a song. What are the best song lyrics to pick someone up with? Radio Miles, who is also, here's a little celebrity endorsement. Radio Miles is Miles from the TikTok 10, which is a famous Australian TikTok quiz with like 500,000 followers that I do every night, and I love it a lot. It is awesome. He said Midnight City by M83, one of my favorite songs of all time. But then his reasoning is what really piqued my interest. He says, Midnight City by M83. This is verbatim what he said. You decipher it. Nightclub scene in the year 10 play. I was dressed as a clown. Instant flashbacks. I don't understand that. So it was a nightclub scene in the year 10 play and you were dressed as a clown. Don't know why a clown was don't know why a clown was at a nightclub. Also don't understand or know why you would be playing Midnight City by M83 in a year 10 play. Because usually in year 10 plays, they do like Shakespeare. Oh, we're doing Romeo and Juliet with the girls' school near us. Oh, we're doing A Midsummer Night's Dream. This is so fun. We're doing it. And then your drama teacher clearly has just been like, I'm doing my own play with songs that I like, including Midnight City by M83. Great one. Finally, Radio Machine Dramon. Thank you for writing into the show. New listener of the show. Love having you on board. Said Adam's Song by Blink-182. An absolute classic. If I was sad in high school, I would listen to it and have it come up on MSN. The biggest emo song in the world. I love that song actually says the words, "I'm too depressed to go on." Like, I realize that's a very serious thing to say, but it's like, it's quite a lame, I think it's a lame lyric because it's just so explicit. There's no subtext to those lyrics at all. It's just like, "I'm too depressed to go on." Good one, Mark Hoppus. Love that song because it actually calls back to a Nirvana song. The lyrics, "I took my time, I hurried up," are a back reference to Nirvana's song, "Come As You Are," where Kurt Cobain says,
"Take your time, hurry up, yours is yours, don't be late."
And that's what this podcast is all about, making links between niche pop culture. Well, Blink-182 and Nirvana aren't niche, but you get the point. Thank you for everyone for writing in. Feel free to keep sending them in if you've got a funny story like any of our listeners this week. It would be awesome to hear them. Two more things before ending today. I did see the clip of Will Smith, of Dave Chappelle famous comedian Dave Chappelle, American comedian, being tackled on stage by, I guess you could say, a protester at a Netflix festival. Found this really interesting for a lot of reasons. First and foremost, I mean, it's obviously in follow-up to Will Smith's attack on Chris Rock that we talked about extensively on this podcast, and there was an episode of this podcast that is titled after that, so go back and listen to that if you haven't already. It is really interesting digesting that whole Will Smith thing still, because, you know, there's a lot of commentary about the fact that Will Smith went up there, hit Chris Rock in the face, sat back down, no one escorted him out. They say they asked him to leave. I don't think that necessarily happened, because they could have forced him to leave. There's surely security there. And then he accepted an award a little bit later. In this instance, someone goes up to Dave Chappelle, I suppose is a controversial-ish comedian amongst particular groups. He obviously had a little bit of controversy last year with his new special, The Closer, and a lot of people didn't like it. Netflix kind of hit back and said, well, you know, this is our platform. We give lots of people voices. And honestly, I think Netflix are, like, reality of business and reality of commercial endeavors is, and this is maybe a sad reflection on our society, but I do think that Netflix aren't going to give up Dave Chappelle because of, like, a loud but vocal minority who really, really disagree. And I think that's just a sad reality of business, that Dave Chappelle is a profitable commodity for Netflix, and it's in their best interest to keep his stuff on the platform and let him say the kinds of things he wants to say in his comedy. Don't think that's a good thing or a bad thing. It just kind of is a reality that of the society we live in. Someone goes up, he's armed. I do think it was a fake gun, but they're armed, and then tries to, before he can really do anything, this person is tackled to the ground and kind of beaten, not beaten, but, like, you know, is roughed up, I suppose is the best term, by various security guards. And I think I read somewhere, again, one of the most well-researched podcasts in the country, guys, Jamie Foxx was involved in tackling him to the ground. And then immediately after, just by pure luck and coincidence, well, probably not, but Chris Rock happened to be there, got on stage, grabbed the microphone off Dave and said this.
Is that Will Smith?
Literally said, is that Will Smith, right? Now, you can point out the obvious sort of differences here. When Will Smith, esteemed celebrity, rich and famous dude, defends the honor of his wife, and because he's a celebrity is kind of allowed to do whatever, no one stops him, no one tackles him to the ground, no one makes him leave, he doesn't get arrested, everything's fine. There's none of that. And then when this, like, nobody does it to Dave Chappelle, it's like, fuck you, tackle to the ground, get him arrested, all this stuff, security piling in. And there's the added angle of, like, now are we living in a world/society where if you don't like what a comedian is saying, you can just go up and hit them, which is obviously not true. You can't do that. No one thinks you can do that. Oh, well, some people clearly do, but is that that kind of does feel like a consequence of the fact that no one stopped Will Smith doing what he did and no one really responded with any kind of harshness. Like, there's still no, I don't think there's any, like, his reputation suffers, like, as collateral, but there's been no, like, direct, well, that being said, he resigned from the Academy, I believe, and there was a lot of backlash there, but, you know, it was a criminal thing that he did. And I do think it's quite interesting that now you can do that, because, like, in the past, I feel like it was, oh, I don't like, it's changed a lot. Because in the past, I thought it was sort of like, I don't like this person, so I don't watch their stuff, I don't go to their events, I don't engage it. Whether it's, I don't find this person funny, I don't like that band's music. Like, for example, there are lots of times where my friends are like, come and see this band live. And I'm like, nah, I don't really like them, so I'm not going. And I know that's a different analogy, but I think people now are so prone on, like, doing this kind of thing, like attacking people, or it's just like, oh, just sit out of it. Like, just, you don't have to do anything. Just don't go to Dave Chappelle's show if you don't like him. Don't support him. Don't give him your money by buying a ticket. just don't do it. That's your choice. And I think one of the lessons I'm learning as I get older, one of the most important lessons I think I'm learning throughout the last few years in particular, throughout the last 12 months in particular, through a lot of things that have happened, one of the main lessons that I am going to take forward with me is that no matter how hard you try, no matter how hard you try, you can't make people behave the way you want them to. You can't make people think the way you want them to, and you can't make people say the things you want them to. You just can't. You can't make anyone do, think, say, feel how you want them to. And that is just a reality that I think is actually kind of hard to accept, that I've been working on more and more this last 12 months after a few personal things that I've had happen, where I'm like, oh, I am upset because I wanted that person to behave and think and respond to me how I wanted them to, and then they didn't. And now I just don't, like, you just can't. And so that's the thing about the whole getting up there and hitting someone in the face because you don't like them. That's ridiculous. But I think, if anything, I do think we now have a new term for this. I think we now have a new term for someone who stands up and tries to attack a comedian on stage. And that term is a Will Smith. You're doing a Will Smith. Like, I like that that is now part of everyday vernacular. If someone stands up and goes up to someone doing a speech, you're Will Smithing it. Ah, oh, he's bloody Will Smithing it. I like that. I want that to continue being part of our vernacular. That's very good to me. I'd love to know people's thoughts on the differences between the Chris Rock and Chappelle kind of thing. Obviously, Chris Rock was there, but yeah, it is. It's interesting, and I hope we don't see this more and more, because I just don't think you can physically attack someone because you disagree with something they've said. You know, that's like level one of being a human. And I think, like, even with politicians, you see a lot of like, oh, he smashed an egg on this politician, or they like did whatever, like assaulted a politician, yelled in there. It's like, I don't know. To me, that never makes me like respect someone if they physically attack anyone. But anyway, people have different values around those things. I want to launch a new segment. I'm launching it today. I'm launching it right now. It'll be the last segment for this week's show. And I want, the theme of this episode, guys, is that you guys are important to the show. You guys help build the show. I need you guys to contribute to the show as much as possible in writing or via the hotline. Here's a new segment. I've been thinking about this for a while, because do you ever like hear a song and you're just like, oh my God, I forgot this song existed. Like, this song, I haven't heard this song in so long, I forgot it existed until right now that it happened to be playing at this moment. This song that came out like 15 years ago, I loved it, but I just have not thought about it or heard it in that long. That's the premise of this new segment. It's called, working title, but it's called Songs You Forgot Existed. I want you to send them in. Send in a song that you think people... It's kind of like on Hamish and Andy, they do Tell Us Someone I Haven't Thought About for a while. This is Songs You Forgot Existed. Send in a song that you think that I forgot existed, or you think a lot of the listeners would have forgotten existed, right? And then we'll do this segment, and then I'm also going to put an Instagram poll on the TCB Pod Instagram. Jump on it for daily memes and posts related to this podcast and the content of this podcast. Please jump on. Good to see 160 or so followers on there. Daily poll. We're going to see how many of us forgot that the song existed. So... here's the first ever one. Send them in for next week, though. Here's the first ever one. Songs that you forgot existed. I certainly forgot that this song existed. And I've got a whole playlist that I'm making of them, but I forgot this song existed. So, guys, let's get into this.
All right, everybody, get ready, because I'm about to play you a song that you forgot existed. That's right, this is a song you definitely have heard, but you totally forgot it existed until now. Here we go, here's the song. You ready? All right, here it is.
I remember
remember that song, but until you just played it, I completely forgot it existed. Now, submit your own!
That was a very clear instruction at the end there, guys. Submit your own. I would love to get, I want to do one every week. It's just a quick segment, just to be like, oh yeah, that song. Do you remember that song? Get Shaky. Who's it is? The Ian Carey Project. The song is by the Ian Carey Project. I reckon it came out 2007. Just got it up on my phone. Had this great moment, right? Ian Carey Project. And if you go onto Spotify, 2009, there you go. If you go onto Spotify right now and type in the Ian Carey Project, it does feel like, ironically, he never finished the project because there is only one song on the Spotify, which is Get Shaky. Ironic that the Ian Carey Project never finished. We never followed up the project. It was just a single, maybe it was just a single song project. It's like, hey, this is the Ian Carey Project. I'm just doing one song. That's my project. Probably failed. Didn't do any more. Do you remember that song? Go on the Instagram at TCBpod right now and vote yes or no. Let me know. Go follow it if you haven't already. Guys, just about wrapping up here. So send them in and let's do this.
The plug.
Thanks for listening, guys. I really appreciate it. Of course, as always, the Patreon. Patreon.com/RadioMike. Again, I'm not going to stop imploring you to please sign up because it does make a huge difference, even $1 or $4 or $5 a month. It does take a lot of time to do this. I do have a proper job that I have to do before all this because I don't really make money from this. I would like to eventually, and that helps when you do that. You can help me achieve that by rating this podcast on Spotify and Apple Podcasts, preferably 5 stars. We do accept 4, but not 3 or under. You have to give that to another pod. That actually really does help. I know people say it helps, but it really does help. Follow the pod at TCBpod on Instagram. Follow me on Instagram, radio.mike. All of these things really count. Tell your friends about the podcast. That's the other thing. Tell your friends. If you're like, hey, I think you'd like this guy. He's a quirky, funny, nerdy guy. I reckon you'd like his show. And one thing I do push this from time to time, and it really would mean a lot, is if you see a reel or a TikTok on Instagram or TikTok that you think is funny, share it on your story. Tag me. Tag the podcast. It just gets more ears around the podcast. It gets more people hearing it, seeing it, discovering it. Again, the podcast is growing a lot. Like, I always see the numbers and it's always kind of increasing, as well as my other pod, Harry Potter and the Boys. So yeah, sharing it around is the best way to support. The YouTube channel, go subscribe there. Working on doing more consistent content there. It is hard again with work, but doing my best. I will have a Doctor Strange full thoughts and discussions this week. I'm going to make that a point. So please check that out if you are so inclined. Harry Potter and the Boys this week episode is with Tom Bainbridge, radio announcer and comedian. Great episode. He does what I would argue is one of the best reads of that podcast, of that book that anyone's done, in a hilarious chapter. The chapter is called Dragons and Burgers. So Harry Potter and the Boys, if you don't know, is my Harry Potter fan fiction pod. Please go and listen to that. As well as that, Hamish and Andy, Hamish and Andy's Remembering Project, and as well as that, Tofop with Will Anderson and Charlie Clawson. Great podcast. And I actually have a live-ish mic now, so I pop up on episodes from time to time as well if you want to hear more of me. That is basically it for now. Thank you so much for listening, guys. Genuinely really appreciate it. Week by week, hearing all of you guys. Oh, one special thing that I was supposed to do at the start that I didn't is a listener write in, and I will explain this in more detail next week. But I got one from Radio Amy Stalinski. Welcome to the radio family. Sent me a message. Happy 25th birthday, Mike. If you're a long-term listener of the show, you get it. If you're a short-time listener of the show, you don't. I'll explain it in another episode, or just go back and binge listen to the whole episode. Guys, I'll see you next week. My name's Radio Mike. This has been Inside of My Mind. Love you short time, also long time. See you later.